Welcome to Americana Archives. Today we have a story entitled The Red Light. It says, Maggie, is the light there?
Yes, Father.
Is it a red light?
Yes, Father, but don't go out tonight. Please don't. Stop at home for your own Maggie's sake.
There were father and daughter, these two speakers, and the only occupants of the little cottage that stood by the cliff near the booming sea. In a pleasant little cottage, where everything was kept bright and cheerful by Maggie, her mother had been dead many a year. They ought to have been happy, and would have been, but for circumstances which will be made known as we progress in our story. Quite a number of people lived in the neighborhood of the cliff, one of whom was named Joe Clay. If there ever was a singular character dwelt on the face of the earth, the same Joe was one. He sold liquor, and when the red light shone from his window, you could have had liquor for cash or for credit. Once in a while, Joe would have what his neighbors termed moral fits come over him and would wake up to seeing how much misery he was causing by his traffic and how wrong it was for him to deal out the liquid poison. At such times, the red light was withdrawn from the window and a white one was placed in its stead. If this light was seen, you might as well try to walk off with the state house as to induce him to let you have a drop of liquor, for he wouldn't do it. Neither love nor money would tempt him to depart from his resolutions. How often and often Maggie wished the white light always was shining there. On the railway, a red light signifies danger, as much as did the one in Joe Clay's cottage to the heart of Maggie. Now what's the use of your wanting to deprive me of having a pleasant evening once in a while, Maggie? Said the child's father. Because it's going to be a wild and dark night, Father, and you always appear so dazed, like when you come home from the clay cottage, that I fear you will lose your way and make a misstep and fall over the cliff. Oh, it is so lonely here for me when you are gone, and I get so nervous and fearful sometimes that I don't hardly dare to look over my shoulder. The very stillness often makes me cry aloud for fear, answered Maggie. There's nothing can harm you, child. Go to bed when I am gone and get to sleep, and I'll wake you up bright and early in the morning with a father's kiss. I could not go to bed, much less go to sleep, knowing you were out. Do stay home, and I'll sing to you all the songs I know, and you shall tell me all about dear mother. There was a tear in the old man's eye, but he wiped it away, saying as he did so, Now, Bertie, don't feel so badly. I'll not be gone long anyway, and maybe I'll bring you back something nice. I'd rather have you stay at home with me than all the nice things you could bring. Well, I can't stay for all that, and all your whimpering and whining can't prevent me from going. Won't you let me go with you? No, I won't. A pretty thing it would seem to have a girl in Joe Clay's barroom. Why, it would look as if I didn't know how to take care of myself. Maggie pleaded no more. She knew from experience, poor child, that it would not be of the slightest use, so she was obliged to let her father have his own way and saw him leave the house, going in the direction of the red light. An hour passed, and Maggie had never felt so lonely before. It grew darker and darker outside. The wind had risen, and the rain commenced to come down in torrents. Fitful flashes of lightning would for a moment light up the scene and then die away, only to make the darkness denser than it was before. The windows rattled in the casements, and the door shook as though someone was striving to gain an entrance. The child crept close to the fire, as though for protection. The old clock struck the hour, but Maggie was so nervous she did not catch the number told, and so she raised her eyes to see. As she did, so she caught sight of a lantern hanging from a beam. There, if Father hasn't forgotten his lantern, exclaimed Maggie to herself. How ever will he find his way home without it such a pitch dark night? Supposing he should have started before this, he would certainly lose his way. The liquor he gets at Joe Clay's would get into his head, and he might fall over the rocks way down into the dreary moaning waves. Perhaps I shall never see him again.
I know what I'll do. I'll just take the lantern and go after him. She did not seem to think of the wild storm outside, or the perilous and dark road she had to traverse. All she appeared to remember was that her father was in danger, and that it was her duty to rescue him from his peril if it were in her power to do so. She covered over the fire with ashes, and having taken all due precautions against a conflagration, she wrapped herself in her cloak, tied her hood closely over her head, and with the lighted lantern in her hand, started forth on her merciful errand. Her progress was slow, for even with lantern alight and the red light shining in the distance but dimly, the road she traveled was full of deceptive holes, into any one of which she might stumble unless she took heed where she placed her little feet. The wind was high, and would often strive to whisk her cloak from her shoulders and snatch the lantern from her hand. But bravely and nobly did this child keep on, praying all the while to God to give her strength to get to the hut of Joe Clay's, praying God to keep him there until she had placed the lantern safely in his hands. Ever and anon would her light be thrown on the surrounding objects, fearing if her father had fallen on the way, she might miss him. The red light never seemed so far off to Maggie as it did that night. It seemed to keep going farther away the more she advanced towards it. What if it should not proceed from Joe Clay's house at all, but merely be some will-o'-the-wisp attracting her towards the sea and then into it? At last it shone brighter and brighter, and Maggie knew she was near her journey's end. Then she could hear loud voices above the storm. Then she approached the window and peered in. She could see Joe Clay and four other men seated around the table, smoking and drinking, but her father was not one of them. Her father was not in the room. Maggie's heart sank within her. A blinding flash of lightning shot through the sky. Maggie gave one wild, piercing scream and fell prostrate below the window. The scream called the men from the room, and as they gazed out into the darksome, boisterous night, this was the scene presented to their view. A little figure, drenched through with the rain, lying on the ground, clasping in her cold hands the lantern. They thought she had been struck by the lightning, but she had only fainted from exhaustion and excitement. "Why, bless my soul," exclaimed Joe Clay, "if it ain't Mark Gordon's little gal Maggie. What could have brought her out such a wild and uncanny night?" They soon knew well enough, for the child opened her eyes, and looking vacantly about, exclaimed, "I've brought the lantern, father." Then, as if the memory of her not seeing her parent came to her mind, she added, "He is not here. He is dead, and Maggie will never see him more." "Don't take on so, little one. Your father's not dead. He's sound asleep in my chamber. He was drowsy-like, and so I thought I'd best put him to bed. He wanted to go home, but I was determined he shouldn't. As he was persistent, I just put him in my room and turned the key upon him," said Joe Clay. Maggie told her story to the men assembled there. It struck deep down into their hearts, and the roughest of them felt a twinge of conscience. "See here, my men," Joe Clay says, and Joe was himself the speaker. "If this wee slip of a gal had died out in this storm, I should always have felt that I murdered her. Yes, just as much as murdered her if I'd shot her down. Now, from this time forth and forevermore, as long as I live on these premises, the light that shines from that window shall never be the danger signal red, but the pure one of white. And you very well know what that means, eh?" "It means that you'll sell no more liquor?" said one of the men. "Precisely so. And you know when I put the white light in the window, you might as well try to make mountains walk as for me to sell liquor." It was a wise resolve of Clay's, better and wiser still that he kept his resolution. It made the cliff better, and the dwellers on it happier. Maggie's father, when he learned how much his child had imperiled her life to save his, forswore the use of the wine cup, and did all in his power to make Maggie's life far pleasanter than it had been before. He never strayed from his hut at night. He told her tales of the dead mother while she listened, and, at their close, would sing him sweet songs of home and heaven. Such is their present life. May their future be as calm and peaceful as it has been since the banishment of that ill omen in Joe Clay's window, the red light. This story came from the great state of South Carolina, being reported in the Port Royal Commercial and Beaufort County Republican of April 30th, 1874. Thank you for joining us today. If you want to continue to uncover all of America's lost and forgotten history, then remember before you leave to hit the subscribe button, hit the notification bell, and remember to like and comment below. And we will see you next time on Americana Archives.